Clemson and Coastal Carolina were supposed to play tonight. Understand the weather's beautiful there now, but earlier today was not so much, so they had to call it early. That's bad for baseball fans. It's good for us because it gives us a chance to welcome in Coastal coach Gary Gilmore to Sports Talk once again. Ordinarily, he'd be walking out about an hour ago with his lineup card to face the Tigers, and he would be walking out to this music.
I was raised off Route 3, out past where the blacktop ends. We'd walk to church on Sunday morning, race barefoot back to Johnson's Fence. That's where I first saw Mary, on that roadside picking blackberries. That summer.
All right, let's welcome in with his walk-up music in the background, Coach Gary Gilmore. We wanted you to feel like you were at home plate tonight.
Well, I'll tell you what, and if I'd have been listening to that tonight, there would have been some tears shed. I can promise you that. Knowing it was the last time, I can promise you.
So yeah.
I appreciate you doing that. Thank you very much.
Well, Chris, that's Chris's call. He said that's your walk-up music, and there's some history about that song and personal for you?
Yes, sir. Yep, absolutely. A lot of those things in my life happened on the red dirt road I grew up on.
That's fantastic. Great song for a great man. What was Saturday like for you? It was a gilly day. I know it was discombobulated because of the weather and the doubleheader and all that, but what was that day like for you?
I mean, it was it's just hard to describe, Phil. Very surreal in a lot of ways. I mean, a lot of the guys had not told me they were coming. We had right around 130 former players show up, and had about 200 texts on my phone. I mean, it was just overwhelming, to be very honest with you. I mean, I just first off, never expected it. Coastal did an amazing job of throwback unis from my generation to the reception after. I mean, I couldn't have asked for anything better.
Are your emotions kind of where you thought they would be at this stage? Or are they maybe running a little bit higher than you thought they would be, knowing that, you know, this is it, it's over as far as home is concerned, and, you know, you got X number of games left?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I mean, I'm hell bent on us. We need to win 5-6 more games so we can, you know. I think that we have some good pieces to our resume, but we got to add some W's to. You know, we dug a hole for ourselves there for about 2.5 weeks, and we got to show everybody we can dig ourselves out. And you know, I'd sure love to have an opportunity to go out in the playoffs and see if we could, you know, really get really hot and make make it tough on somebody in a regional somewhere and end it, you know, if it ends that way, so be it. But, you know, I mean, I'm at peace, whatever happens. I mean, I'm very, very blessed and to have been a college coach for 39 years and, you know, got a chance to be a play a guy, extended his career beyond college for a little bit. And, you know, I can't, God took me today. I die a very happy man.
Yeah. You know, the trip to Creighton was kind of special and fun, going out to Omaha and playing out there. You lost both of those games, and that was the start of the 8-game losing streak. Did that trip maybe, I don't know, did it take a little something out of your team that bled over into the next two series?
We just quit hitting to a certain degree. One of the few times in my career we just offensively, I mean, heck, we gave up 4 runs in the games at Creighton and couldn't win. And the crazy part, we scored 3 runs. You know, we thought we scored 3 runs in the first inning of both games, mm-hmm. and then completely shut it down. And, then we came back from that trip and had Troy, who was a hot team, and still is a hot team. And, you know, we just, this overwhelmed us. And I think our kids were, we put a lot into the Lafayette series because they came in with the second-ranked ERA in the country. And, you know, we wanted to prove we could score off of those guys, and you know we had a good weekend there, and you know against a great team, and you know I mean baseball's a crazy game, man. You know, it's funny. I was actually believe it or not, I was actually starting to put some things away in my office today with the rain out, and I ran across a commemorative magazine that our university did of our championship run in 2016. It's so funny. The same thing that happened, we didn't lose 8 in a row, but we went through a really pretty bad stretch early in the year in 16 where, you know, there was a quote of me going, well, you know, at this moment in time, there's nothing that works for Coastal baseball. We can't pitch. We can't hit. We can't steal base. We can't catch the ball. We can't. There's nothing that works. Well, that we went through that about 2-3 weeks ago. I'm going, damn, you know. So, you know, it's all, you know how our game is, man. It can turn. I mean, if somehow we can play really well this weekend and get ourselves going again, you know, I mean, we scored plenty of runs this past week. We didn't pitch quite well enough in the one game against Georgia State and gave up too many home runs, and they were able to beat us 10-9, and outside of that, we scored plenty of runs. You know, we played offensively more like we did in the beginning of the year, and we just, we got to get back to pitching a little bit better, and we're going to have to play our behinds off, because Marshall's got their back to the wall too, so it's going to be, it's going to be a tough series. And I know they have two exceptionally good starting pitchers and one really good bullpen guy. So it's, they're two starters, and one guy's been pitcher of the week in our league at least 3 times, maybe 4. And so that, it's going to be a handful for us. But if we're worthy of playing beyond, we have to rise to the occasion, and we have to forget what it was like 2-3 weeks ago and put it all back together and get some momentum going.
Coach, somewhere in this house, I've got a copy of that commemorative magazine too. I need to lay my hands on that and read back through those quotes.
Yeah, yeah, Gilmore, head baseball. I hadn't looked at that thing, Chris, in forever.
I've got a copy of it somewhere. I just can't find it. Gilmore with us here tonight. Coastal Carolina and Clemson supposed to play tonight. And, Coach, take us behind the scenes. How does a rainout take place? How did you – do you talk with Clemson? Do you talk with Eric Backage and say, here's what we're thinking? He has to agree. How did all that come about today?
I mean, it started yesterday. Eric and I talked. And, both of us could, we can look at the radar and the forecast and the whole 9 yards. And, they're still in Clemson, so – I've made that trip way more times than Clemson's ever made it here. So I know, not against our state. That is not a fun 4.5-hour ride. I can promise you that. I don't care win or lose, but have to drive in and, do it the day of and show up, get off the bus, play and do all that. I mean, obviously it's not only wear and tear on your players, it's cost of hotels and buses and everything else. And I had been watching it, starting on Sunday. I'd really started watching it because, the forecast on Sunday was like 27 straight hours of rain here. It was like 4 a.m. on Tuesday morning till, like 12 o'clock or what, 10 o'clock or something on Wednesday morning. So, they actually began to deteriorate a bit, and it's amazing. We got one really heavy downpour today, but we missed two gigantic thunderstorm bursts that got Myrtle Beach and got the other side of Conway. It was like it split right between the two when it got to us, and when the decision was made at 9 o'clock this morning for them to either get on the bus and come or not, the forecast from all of the resources we use said that, it was a long shot to play. And at that point in time, for them to drive down here and not play would have been really miserable. You look at how it is right now and you go, huh, a lot of people can point fingers. It just, you know, you know, none of us can play God and determine what the weather's going to be like. You do mm-hmm. the best that you can to make the best decision for everyone involved. And, you know, I mean, same thing happened to us when we went to their place, you know, so it just one of those things. And, you know, I hate it because, I mean, I definitely would have, you know, I'd love to have played one more game or whatever, but, I mean, it is what it is. And, you know, once you make the decision, you just move on. You know, I mean, heck, I've, you know, me and everyone else around us has been wrong before. You know, it's not an exact science. And, you know, anyone that ever gets into baseball as a head coach needs to have studied meteorology at some point in time in their life. Because it's the most amazing thing. I mean, they look at me like I'm some weather guru or something. I mean, you know, holy cow, man. Come on. I'm guessing like the rest of you are, guys.
Ryan McGee wrote a phenomenal piece about you and your career for ESPN.com. I enjoyed reading it today, and several stories in there that I had not heard from you before. If you don't mind sharing with our fans and listeners, how close were you to actually giving up on baseball in 1997?
Oh, I was done. I mean, I had the thing signed in my hand, and, you know, Coastal was a wonderful place at that point in time, but there was, you know, my dreams and desires of where I wanted to go were not the dreams and desires of the university at that point in time. I know they thought I must go home and smoke some wacky weed or whatever at night, thinking we could go to Omaha or whatever, you know, but, you know, I mean, You have to dream big if you want to achieve big. In my personal opinion, I've felt like that my whole life. You know, you want to be a big leaguer, you got to dream to be a big leaguer, you know. And, you know, you want to just dream to be a college player, you got to dream to be a big leaguer if that's what you want to be. And, you know, it was very frustrating. We weren't very good. The facility had been allowed to run itself. You know, they had allowed when the pro team left, I mean, the facility had run itself down. It was not good at all. And, you know, it was just tough. I was putting 24/7 into it all the time. And, you know, I mean, part of it, guys, to be very honest with you, I took an $11,000 pay cut to leave Aiken to come there and to walk into a place that I loved from my experience playing there. And the playing surface was terrible. The teaching part of the cages and the this and the that, whatever. It overwhelmed me, to be very honest with you. Just all the things that I had to figure out how to navigate to actually move forward and be successful again. And, you know, it was one of those things. I mean, my wife and I, you know, we had joined the Myrtle Beach Community Church when we moved there. Pastor Ronnie Bird was really good friends with my community church guy from Aiken when I was there. So we started there. We had been in a elementary school, moved to the high school as the church grew over those 2 years. And they had just purchased this country music theater there at Waccamaw Pottery, which was a thriving area at that time. And, I don't know. It's like God took the steering wheel and just yanked it to the right and said, man, before you do this, go in there and have a sit down with this guy. And we talked for almost 2 hours, and, you know, he made me look at some things a little bit different, made me realize that, you know, I couldn't put a timeline on God's plan. If God had a plan for me to be successful there, I had to stay with it until someone else made a decision to tell me, I wasn't the right guy for that job. And, you know, it was very interesting. I mean, the very next year, you know, we started to turn it around. And, you know, from there, just, you know, wasn't always a ride the top of the wave type deal. But, I mean, we started moving forward, and, you know, we had a bump in the road here and there. But, you know, the crazy thing about every bump in the road we had, when we came out of it the next year, we became better. The whole entire organization became better. We learned from our failures. We fixed things. We did this. We did that. And, you know, until they built Springbrook Stadium, you know, the program was always ahead of the overall support from the school. You know, we We outperformed what the resources that we had. And, you know, once we won, I mean, things have been, you know, the last 7-8 years have been, you know, they've been very kind to me, to our program, to our assistants, to everything else. And, you know, I know they're very proud of what all was achieved during the time I was there. And, you know, I'm very blessed that, you know, that through my faith, I stuck with it, and you know, and it paid off for me. You know, there's absolutely no doubt, because, you know, I'll tell anyone, I've told a million people that, you know, there was faith and things that went on and to get us to Omaha, and while we were in Omaha, that there was, I'll go to my grave believing that, you know, I don't believe God determines who wins baseball games, but He also helps people believe they're good enough to do it. And that was one of the parts that there was no doubt in my mind that, you know, that our kids played as good as they could play. And that at the end of the day, when you get on that stage, it's a team that plays the best. It's not always the one with the most talent.
So I take it that Coastal is the beneficiary of you giving up on what appeared to be a pretty solid high school football career.
Yeah, I'm not sure about that. All I can remember is going to North Carolina and Arkansas and being recruited. And heck, man, I was, you know, heck, man, I always could really run. But, you know, shoot, I was a whopping 155 out of high school. So, I'm meeting these guys and looking up at them, and they're talking about their 40 times. I'm going, damn, man, I ain't sure I can outrun all these guys anymore. You know, I better stick with baseball.
Well, I'd say it's a wise decision because it's played out well for everybody. So, I mean, on the positive side, you walk away your last home game this past weekend. You walk away from there a winner. And you got a chance now to go and maybe win enough games and get yourself, you know, back in the – where do you think you are with the NCAA committee? I mean, you can go down – I guess you can go down the hall and talk to the chairman of the committee and say, where are we? But remind him.
I mean, the things that we have going for us is, I mean, we've not played very well in our league, which our league is, you know, the fourth-rated league in the country. So, I mean, you know, that plays into it. Our out-of-conference schedule, strength of schedule, is second in the country. You know, our out-of-conference ranking is we're 17th, you know, if you just do that. So, I mean, there's some positives, but, I mean, again, I'm realistic. I understand the, you know, the difficulty of getting in to begin with and all the political stuff and the dynamics of everything. I mean, we're not getting in with 30 wins. We got to win 35, 36 games. I feel like if we get to that point, I think our resume is good enough to, you know, again, you know, I've also been around it enough to know if there are enough upsets around the country, people like us get bumped off the board, even if we get to that point. So, but I do think our strength of schedule will help us. You know, I mean, you know, to have a out of conference schedule number two in the country is, I mean, you play half your schedule outside the league. So, I mean, you know, that definitely should help us. And like I said, with our conference being the fourth strongest conference in the country right now, that has to help us in some manner.
Absolutely. All right. What will be the day after you take off the cleats for the last time, whenever that is? You know, maybe it will be this month. Maybe it'll be sometime in late June. Who knows? But the next day, what do you want to do as a man who is free of responsibility?
I'll be honest with you. I'll probably grab my grandson here, and we'll probably go out on the boat and go fishing a little bit or something like that, just to unwind and stuff and everything. The one thing I will tell you that I want to do, everybody's asked me, guys, and what I want to do when I retire, which I have thought about it long and hard and had a couple, you know, had two or three guys talk with me that I have great respect for or whatever. And because of the fact that I have, you know, I have these two different types of cancer, et cetera, all that kind of stuff. You know, one of the things that crushes me when I go to Houston for my treatments is going through, you know, through part of that, through the Children's Hospital. So I think one of the things I want to try to do in my lifetime, if I can pull it off, is create a NCAA Division 1, 2, and 3 National Children's Cancer Awareness Day and see if we can't have every ballpark in the country bring out kids and make people aware of that, the fact that children's cancer research is the lowest funded research of cancer in our country, and that us in college baseball want to make people aware of it, and we want to make a difference and see if we can raise $10, $15 million a year.
Wow. That'd be
amazing.
Awesome. Listen, we're going to let you go. Thank you for taking time out on what should have been a work day for you. I would say right now you'd be kicking Eric Backich's butt about 7-0, and he'd be fussing at somebody over there. But listen, good luck. Hopefully, we'll have more baseball to talk with you. Memorial Day, we'll be doing our show as we do, talking with the coaches headed to the postseason. Hopefully, we'll make that phone call to you, and you'll be part of the group. So, best of luck. We'll talk to you again soon, and we appreciate your time tonight.
Thank you, Coach.
Always, man, and I hope very much so that we're talking on Memorial Day.
Thank you, sir. Take care.
All right, guys. Take care.
Thank you. Bye. You know, I think I can say this accurately. The great Gary Gilmore.
Oh, absolutely.
I mean, you don't use that word lightly, because not only is he a great baseball coach, he's a great person and, you know, a man who has looked cancer in the eye and has fought it. He hasn't beat it, because he's going to have it the rest of his life, but with great doctors and a great plan, you know, they've been able to keep it at bay. So, I mean, really, a few years ago, I thought he was going to be done.
Yeah,
when he first announced this thing, it was very serious. It is still very serious.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't see any way he could keep it going.
He actually went to Houston last week. Mm-hmm. For another round of chemo in between their game, their win over UNC Greensboro this past weekend with Georgia State. Don't do this often, but I would encourage anybody. You don't have to be a Coastal fan. You're just a fan of sports and a fan of good people like Gilly is. Read the piece that Ryan McGee did for ESPN.com on him, because it's phenomenal stuff. And it's stuff, and I've been around Gilly for a long, long time, stuff I never knew. And I wasn't joking with him. He was evidently all-conference at quarterback in high school. He ran the Veer.
Mm.
Now, you look at him now, and can you imagine him running the Veer option?
Could have played for Jim Carlin. They ran the Veer back in the day.
Yeah,
so,
but
he grew up. I mean, he grew up on a red dirt road, as you mentioned, and that's why it's his walk-up music. So, okay, well, thanks to Gilly for being with us tonight. Good luck to him up there at Marshall. Big weekend for them if they can win those games and win a couple of games. Where is their tournament this year?
It's in Montgomery, Alabama.
Okay.
Where the Montgomery Biscuits, mm-hmm. if I'm not mistaken, their minor league part, that's where they played the Sun Belt.
You know, it's kind of sad with this rainout against Clemson. He only played two games against in-state teams this season. They were both against upstate. Didn't play Clemson. Of course, South Carolina wasn't on the schedule. That's a shame. And I guess, you know, he wanted to schedule a tough national schedule, and he did that. So I guess that meant not playing a lot of the, you know, other teams in South Carolina. Hit the break. Be back in a moment.